idea of a still life, but what I want you to do is set up your still life of some everyday objects and make sure you got some good lighting on the surface, and take some photographs, at least 5 or 6 photos of different viewpoints, and decide which one's going to suit your layout for your drawing. Something when you do complete your drawing or work on your drawing, you don't have to include every object in there, or you can take away and add objects. It's kind of your choice. That's the privilege of being the artist and creating your own still life and your own work, is you can pick and choose what you want in there, and you're not bound to the photograph itself. Once you've chosen your photo from the ones that you have taken of your still life that you set up, then you can use it as a reference to start your layout. Now, when I start my layout, I usually want to have a good location of my objects. So I usually will draw a little border, or just square, put my corner squares and mark those in first, so I have a border lined up. Now, I don't always adhere to this border, but it helps me focus my objects towards the center of the paper that I'm drawing on. So here I'm drawing on a 6x9 inch sheet of paper. It's not very large, but it's enough so I can get the information down and make a quick sketch. I'm going to speed this up. All I'm going to do first is the line drawing, so you can see this fast forward. Here you want to use your mechanical pencil, or you can use a 2B pencil or whatever you have. Draw very lightly though, not with a heavy hand, just to get your layout. Of course, at this point you should be able to observe and render or sketch the objects that you're seeing in fair proportion. This also gives you a chance if your proportions aren't correct, you can correct those proportions. Also indicate where your light source comes from, add your value, and the next step I would do is to blend in some of these tones to get a nice gray tone. And this really works as your halftone and keeps you from going into detail at first before you get your layout. Stop for a minute, take a look at it and see if you like it. If you don't like it, make some changes. This is a point where you've spent maybe, 5 minutes on your total drawing so far. So this is where, if you want to continue with your sketch, continue on. If you don't, stop and start another one, or make your corrections at this point. Alright, this is the part that everybody loves to do, the rendering part of a drawing. But if you skip the layout step first and go right into the rendering drawing, chances are high that your proportions are going to be incorrect. And so I highly recommend that you do your layout and your light sketch first, and then start penciling in all your cool details, your dark shadows, your reflections, your midtones, putting in some hatching, cross-hatching marks if you want to go that far. There's so much you can do. But a lot of my students will skip that first step and go to this step, and then their proportions are incorrect. And they ask me, "Mr. A, how do you like that?" And I say, "Man, that looks good, except for this proportion's off a little bit over here." And it's a real downer to put, hours and hours into your work and your proportions aren't correct. I've been there. I hate doing that, working a long time in your work and still don't get the proportions correct, and do all this splendid, beautiful rendering, and you know the drawing turns out you know hopeless at that point. So make sure your proportions are in good shape before you actually start your rendering. I'm going to speed up this rendering part because this is the long part of your drawing. This is about 20 minutes, so I'm going to speed it up. Alright, just to let you know, this is not a drawing lesson. It's about adding color, but we have to do the drawing part first. So here I'm doing some rendering very quickly, just working with a 6B pencil. I'm not going to get into various pencils and stuff like that. And this lasts, again, like about 20 minutes to complete this sketch. So you want to take your time and get all your values and your tones in place and your reflections. And think about contrast as you're doing this again. You want very strong contrasting areas that show up a lot in your drawing. Think about texture and non-texture areas. Okay. Once you've completed your rendering of your drawing, then you want to start to set up your watercolor kit. And you're just going to need a small flat quarter brush and a small round brush. It can be 00, 01, or 02, as long as it's got a fine tip on it. I'm going to start off with a flat brush. Here I've got a limited palette. It's a school kit palette we use in school for our students. Very beginning. And what we're going to do is a color wash over the pencil drawing, and it's almost like in the past when we used to hand color photographs. It's kind of the same process, and the cool thing is that your values show up underneath. Now it depends on how much pigment you use. If you're going to really saturate it, I wouldn't hit it with full saturation. Keep your pigments kind of wet so you can control how much, how dark and how light the pure colors are going to be. So here I'm using the red over the graphite pencil, and you can see I get this maroon color. It's kind of really washed out, but what happens once this starts to dry, I can go back and now I can add more pigment to it and I can make the color more intense. I can control that. The trick is not to hit your highlights. Keep your highlights white because you're still using that watercolor, and the white of your paper is the white area of your subject. So think about those highlights from your rendering as your laying down your first coat. Here you can see I add a little more pigment and the color's brilliant with the red over the gray tones. Okay, so cut your edges clean. That's why if you got a clean flat brush to do this, you can cut your edges or go back and use your 00 or 0 round watercolor brush. That works very well too. Alright, so the wash part is, you could do so many things with this that you can't do with any other medium as far as controlling like brush stroke. You can go in and add some more lines in there by just developing a darker value with your paint. You can build it up and even make it more brilliant. Here I'm adding a second coat after I went over the second part. The first part's already starting to dry. Now I'm working on a dry surface. It's not a wet surface, so the paint will not bleed as easily. So controlling the water takes a little practice. So I recommend have a scrap sheet of paper off to the side and paint on it. Once you've mastered that control, then use that. The paint doesn't, it doesn't adhere right off the bat, so you've got a couple seconds to move it around and build your value up. But it does absorb pretty quickly. I think, what is this, 100? I think this is 100 weight that I'm drawing on, 100 weight drawing paper. So it's not that thick, but it holds pretty well. So again, here your materials are minimal to get a good sketch out. And a lot of times I'll do this out in the field, work with these materials, get a rendering or some sketches of something that I'm interested in. Use this very same process to complete some of my artwork. So this is a cool process to do. It's old. It's not a new process. It's been around for a long time. But with modern technology, I think it's becoming a thing of the past. But it shouldn't be something that, you know, that artists should overlook. So you get some really nice effects with this that you can't get any other way, even with modern technology. So, especially in a short amount of time, this whole drawing, you know, is under an hour. So to get a sketch in under an hour, a full color sketch is, you know, it's nothing to laugh at. I mean, it's a lot of work and there's a lot of thought process going into it. But once you develop your hand-eye coordination skills and you have a pattern of how do you want to develop your coloring effect, you know, it can work really well for you. And then you can take this kind of work and you can take another photograph of it, or you can download it and put it into Photoshop or Illustrator, anything like that, and work from there and enhance it even further. But again, this is your artwork and it's all your creativity, from taking the photograph yourself to deciding what objects you want in there, how you're going to render them, how you want to use your contrast of values, where you have maybe you have some soft tones versus texture. Here I'm going to use red and greens in the work. Red and greens is a traditional way, but of course, you know, red and greens are opposite on the color wheel, so they will automatically have contrast, and you could take a simple value drawing and really give it some interest, and it'll hold the viewer, you know, hold the viewer's response for a little more time than just a simple value drawing would. And plus, it's a lot of fun to do and to learn a lot to do it. Learn a lot while we're doing this work. All right, let me speed this up. Just a reminder, make sure that you clean your brush out very well when you start mixing your colors. Again, here's a limited palette. I need a yellow green to paint the apples, so I'm mixing kind of this dirty yellow here with the green so I can get this yellow green, and I'm just going to lay it over the apples, remembering to keep my highlights light. Okay, I mean, don't add any paint in there, and water it down as you work along to your lighter areas and let your values show through underneath your wash. And this is a quick way of getting a rendering a value with just one pigment or one color and your water wash. And it turns out to be pretty effective. Okay, so here I'm going to do the two apples together, same wash. I haven't even dipped back into the paint yet. Okay, so here I'm going to add more pigment, like I had before, and build up the darker value. That's cool with these flat brushes. You can cheat a little bit and turn them sideways and pull some lines. You'll figure it out how it comes together for you. Alright, and in this particular case, when you're painting, remember to paint your objects to where your hand doesn't get into your work. So give it enough time so you can paint one object and then move to another object, move to another object. Just like you're coloring in a color book. Okay, but here you're using your watercolor paint as your medium. Alright, so let's speed this up so we can move on. Remember, when you start your line work, mix your black with your brown or black and blue. It really makes your black a lot richer. And use a fine point brush, okay? You can also do this with a flare marker or a repeatograph pen or India ink, however you want to work your blacks in. But I like to add color in there. It kind of bounces around with the other colors as you do that. Sometimes the blues will predominate or the browns, and it's just not straight up black. And of course you can add, with the watercolor, you can add water to it and lighten the value of it also for some of your line work. This is just like drawing with the brush. So remember, this is a drawing. It's really not considered a painting. We're drawing, we're using a watercolor, but it's still, we're just doing a basic watercolor wash for our drawing part of our artwork by adding color in this manner. So take your time with your rendering and your line work. And also the cool thing is, with this you can add hatching lines, cross hatching lines in there, and thick or thin lines, lots of line variation. You can put designs into your work very easily at a rapid pace. You can change color and draw with color. You're not really limited to just what your pen can offer you, because you have a wide variety of colors here next to you. I think a lot of times we overlook this watercolor kit, simple watercolor kit, and what you can actually get out of it into your artwork. And I'm still learning new ideas and ways to create different effects that you can get with simple everyday objects, like here in a still light. Here I'll speed this part up and then we'll wrap this one up. Thank you. So this is a great way to illustrate pictures for whatever you need it for, stories, books, if you haven't picked up on that yet. And the techniques are valid. They work tremendously for a lot of artists. And I really enjoy working this way, and I appreciate you watching this. So I hope to catch you on the next video. Take care.